Yes. 5:11. I again welcome everyone here with folded hand for be the part of our group, not my group, Igniting Power Engineer. Objective is very much to disseminate knowledge, to share knowledge, and to inculcate good things, good thought in the young engineers so that they can move further, so that they can contribute in the progress of our nation. Because there are three important things are there: confidence, courage, and passion. And objective is to uplift the life of young engineers. And I always say we are learners, and I'm a learner, because what happens when you are a learner, you have to keep three things in your mind. First of all, you have to learn. You have to learn it perfectly. You have to go into depth. You have to get yourself qualified, ready to implement whatever you have learned. Because what happens in your mind, it is nothing. It is full of traffic of thought. And you have to choose your path. We come to our life, we come to existence without a map. There is no map. We have to choose our path diligently, perfectly. We have to choose our path, where we want to go. We should be ready to accept the challenges, because challenges make us strong. And that was a challenge to start a group, and it was not quite easy job to start that group. It seems to be easy. Behind that starting of group, there are so many stalwarts, so many good peoples. And if I don't take the name of that people, that will be my mistakes. I don't want to fail in my duty. And I would like to start with Honorable P.P. Bhai Sahab. He has joined. I welcome him. Sahil sir, P.K. Rajput sir, Sunny Nagpal sir, who are well connected with me on LinkedIn, who motivate me every day, day and night. They keep on motivating me. Respected Anjuli ma'am, respected Abhav sir, who contributed very well. And he was a part of our very first webinar. Vikas ji, Gopa sir, K.K. Murthy sir, N.K. Mittal sir, P. Ramachandran sir, Dr. Rajamani. No one can think anything in the power industry without these stalwarts. Sanjay Patki ji, Mehta sir, Manas Kundu ji, Sanjay Agarwal ji, Yugesh Sood ji, J. Pandey Ima, Saket Gupta, very good friend of mine, S.K. Batra ji, CBIP, Sanjeev Banerjee, P.K. Patnaik. He is the person who has good thought, who want to do something for the nation. With so many groups, he is running in a parallel. Hats off to him. Special thanks to ELP Alliance. And last but not the least, Surinder Jain, who accepted my request to be the part of this webinar and accepted to give one session on earthing of power cable. And now, without wasting my any time, I'm going to hand over to Surinder Jain. Surinder Jain ji, come on the stage and put that stage on fire. And we know you can do anything. You have to put that stage on fire with your knowledge you have and start sharing on the subjects for which you have been chosen for. Welcome, Surinder ji. Hand it over to you right now.
Good evening, everyone. I am very happy to have this chance to give my presentation. Thank you, each and every one of you are being here with us. Especially thanks to Mr. Rajesh Arora ji, who has given me an opportunity to deliver today's presentation. Before I start my presentation, let me introduce myself first. Myself, Surinder Jain, working with KI Industries as a head of EHV Cable Systems. Today, I will share my presentation. The basic objectives is the grounding principles of the EHV cable systems. So can I start?
Please share your screen, sir.
Okay, thank you. Everyone can see the screen?
Yes, sir, we can see. Please move ahead.
Thank you. So the main topic today's presentation is the grounding principles of the high voltage cable systems. Basically, just we are talking about the bonding schemes mainly for the single core cables, because in three core cables, generally, we are doing the both in bonding. So generally the bonding scheme will appear only in the case of the single core cables here. The main objectives of this presentation are, first the explain the physical background of the induced voltages. What is the background of the induced voltages in the case of the single core cables? What are the different type of the bonding schemes which can do in EHV cable systems? What are the pros and cons of the different bonding schemes? How just we will select the appropriate bonding scheme here? And finally, the correct applications of the bonding in the grounding cables. Generally, we ignore them, but these are very important. The selection of the bonding in the grounding cables, both the cross-sectional areas of the cables as well as the voltage grade of these cables. First, we will start with the basics of the presentation. This is the basic design of the EHV XLP cable. The most important part of every cable is a copper, is a conductor. The conductor may be copper or the aluminum, and the construction of the conductor can be either the Millikan conductor or the circular, depending on the cross-sectional area. Second one is the semiconducting layers of the inner semicon layer, then the XLP insulation. Insulation may vary. Generally, it can be EPR, it can be XLP, but generally for the EHV cable system, we prefer the cross-link polyethylene insulations. And the outermost layer will be the semiconducting layer. Generally, we apply all these three layers, inner semicon, XLP insulation, and the outer semicon in a single process to avoid any contaminations. Above that, just we have to provide a sheeting, screening basically. That will be can a copper screen, that can be a lead screening, that will be aluminum corrugation screening, depending on the customer requirements. And finally, the mechanical protection or for the insulating point of view, just we have to provide the outermost screen that can be PVC or PE jacket. So you can see in the cable, basically there are two metallic components. That is, the one is the conductor and second one is the metallic sheath, or you can say metallic screen. And less are the insulating layers. So the cable is a combination of the conductors and the insulators. These are the main cable components. Basically, the conductor of the cable is always at the high potential. So just we are providing the and the screen, the second metallic component will be there, the ground potential. So the electric field is shielded by the metallic. So sheath means the electric field is shielded by the metallic screen or sheath. So to do so, the screen must be grounded at least one point. Otherwise, in the absence of the grounding of the sheath, either at the one end, it will be the voltage will be the floating. These are the basic constructions you can see here. First is the conductor, inner semicon, insulation, outer semicon. You can see another one, the black. This is a water soluble tapes, generally for providing. It acts as a bedding for the screening purpose, as well as it provides a moisture barrier also for the cables. You can see both construction. Left hand side there is aluminium corrugated cables, and the right hand side is a lead sheet cables. You can see here. In the case of aluminium corrugation cables, you can see that there is an absence of the copper wire screening, because aluminium is a very good conductor of electricity, and alone aluminium is able to carry the required earth fault levels. So there will be no requirement of the copper wire screening. But in case of lead sheet cables, there will always be requirement of the copper wire screening, because the earth fault levels in India is very high. So alone lead is not able to meet the required fault levels. So just we have to provide the copper wire screening along with the lead sheet to meet the specified fault levels. And above that, just we have to provide either the PVC sheet or the PE sheet for the mechanical protection. So what is the function of the screen or metallic sheet? Just we are talking about the induced voltages. So the main function of the screen is the, they will conduct the cable charging current. They will carry the short circuit current in the case of fault. They will reduce the impact on the neighboring cables in case of any short circuits. They will provide us a radial water moisture barrier. And they also provide us a safe earth potential at the cable surface. Basically, why the voltage will be induced in the screens? The current flow in the inner conductor of a cable creates a magnetic field which induces voltages into the own cable screen as well as the onto the screen of the neighboring or surrounding cables. Because generally all in EHV cables, because just we are supplying a three-phase voltage. So let us say if we are talking about the R phase, so the screen of the R phase, the current flowing in the conductor creates a induced voltages in the screen of R phase, always the B and Y. So you can see the formula here is the induced voltages depends on the mutual inductance, the length of the earthing circuit, and the amperes, which will we are flowing through the conductor. This is the basic photograph for the how the induction will place. Now just we are talking about the grounding methods. Basically, there are three types of bonding schemes here. First is the both end bonding. Both end bonding means just we are grounding the sheath at the both ends. So there will be no standing voltage at each end. So induced voltage will be in zero. But in this case, circulating currents will be there. Because of the circulating currents will flow in the opposite direction to the conductor current. So net current will be, net conductor current will be less. In the case of single end bonding, we are earthing at direct earthing at the sending end, and just we are standing open at the receiving end. So just we are connecting the sheath of the receiving end through SVLs. So in this case, there will be a standing voltage. There will be no circulating current, and we are getting the better currents as compared to the both end bonding. And final, the cross bonding schemes. Cross bonding schemes is like a single end bonding scheme, just you can say, because in this case also, this is applicable where we are just providing the long circuit lengths. And we will explain one by one next slides. This is a both end bonding. You can see here, both the sending end as well as the receiving end are directly earthed, and there will be no standing voltage here. Both the, so circulating current will be here in this case. What are the pros and cons in case of the both end bonding? Safety, first of all. Maximum safety as cable screen is firmly grounded at both ends. So there is no harmful voltages in this case, induced voltages or currents. Due to the screen grounding at both ends, a circulating current is induced. The circulating current helps reducing the external magnetic fields losses. The circulating current causes the additional losses. The current depends mainly on the axis distance of the cables. Length limits. As the circulating current is independent of the length and the induced voltage is zero, so length of the earthing section is not limited. Cost. Low cost because we are not providing any additional bonding or earthing cables here. We are not providing any sheath voltage limiters here. Additional equipment is low cost as no additional equipment is needed. Second one is the single end bonding. Single end bonding, you can see here the sending end is directly earthed, but the receiving end is earthed through a SVL. SVL is nothing but a zinc, it's a zener diode which acts as an insulator in case of the normal conditions, but acts as a conductor when a fault occurs. In this case, safety potential dangerous is as induced voltage occurs. Protection against the accidental contacts necessary, induced voltages. Due to the open screen circuit, no circulating currents possible. Because of the absence of the no circulating currents, the current we are getting in the conductors will be much better as compared to when we are doing the both end bonding. Losses without circulating currents, the additional losses will be the minimal. Only the eddy current losses will be there. Length limits. As the induced voltages must not exceed the certain values, the length of the earthing section is limited. Basically, we have to see the induced voltages under the normal conditions as well as the under the short circuit conditions. Under the normal condition, generally we have to see the utility guidelines. In India, generally the maximum induced voltage is around the 65 volts. And under the short circuit condition, generally the limit is around the 6 or 9 kVs because we are doing testing our cables at the 10 kV DC for 1 minute when we are laying our cables. Cost. To ensure the correct function of the SVLs, an earth continuity conductor needs to be placed alongside the cables. So the cost will be higher as compared to the both end bonding because of the additional cost of the sheath voltage limiters as well as the earth continuity cables. The applications typical for the short HV connections, but also for LVM MV cables in case of the large phase distances. Just I will explain later on why we are saying here in the case of the large phase distances. You can see in these slides, we can lay the single core cables either in the flat formations or the trefoil formations. The induced voltages generally depends on the currents, cable sheath diameters, length of the cable sections, frequencies, and the fault currents, and axial spacing between the conductors. In the case of the flat formation, the distance between the phases is much higher as compared to the trefoil formations. So in this case, the induced voltages will be more. So you can refer the first slide where if we are laying our MV cables in the large phase distances, the induced voltages will be more. So we can do the single end bonding in that case. Nothing but the frequency is the same in India, 50 Hertz. So generally we don't consider this one, but if we are quoting for export inquiries, then we have to see what will be the impact on the induced voltage if frequency will be increased by 50 Hertz to 60 Hertz. Cable sheath diameter is also a dependent factor, but it is a very less impact on the induced voltages. Length of the cable section is very, very dominating factor because as the length of the earthing section increases, our induced voltage increases. And short circuit current. In the case of the fault, we have to calculate the induced voltages under the fault conditions. both in the single phase as well as the three phase. These are the typical graph. You can see here, the sheath voltage is directly proportional to the cable length. Cable length means earthing section, length of the earthing section. Induced voltage is directly proportional to the system frequency, whether it is a 50 hertz or the 60 hertz, just we have to calculate. Induced voltage is directly proportional to the conductor current. If we are using a 1000 square mm copper conductor and we have to carry the current around 600 amps, so length of the earthing section may vary if we have to carry the current only 300 amps in the case of 630 square mm cable. The earthing of the length of the earthing section will vary because the maximum induced voltage is already being defined here, whether it is 65 volts or 60 volts, depending on the utility requirements. Sheath voltage is inversely proportional to the mean sheath diameter of the cables. But it is, again, I'm saying it is a very less impact on the sheath voltages. So generally we are not considering it. And the second major factor is the axial spacing between the cables. Generally, we are laying the cables in the trefoil formation, just the cables will be in the touching formation, in the trefoil formations, or we are laying the cables in the flat formations. Today in all metros, the cables will be laid in the trefoil formation, but depending on the utility requirements, we are also laying the cables in the flat formations or also in the open trefoil formations in Mumbai also. But again, just induced voltage, the important parameters are the mean sheath diameter of phase to phase distance, length of the cable section, operating currents, and short circuit currents. These are the graphs. Induced voltages. This is the limited by the electrical properties of the outer sheath. I have already told the withstand voltage according to IEC should be 10 kVDC for 1 minute, or you can calculate it, or you can even check for the AC voltages also. Over voltage due to the short circuit current must be below this value. Higher values to be limited by the SVLs. Typical SVL values are the 3 kV or 6 kV, just we are using. Up to 6 kV, generally we are using the 3 kV SVLs, and beyond that, just we are using the 6 kV SVLs. Now we are talking about the single end bonding. You have already seen just we have to use the earth continuity wire here. What is the requirement of the earth continuity cable here? To avoid or any minimize different earth potential at both cable ends, and to ensure the correct operations of the SVLs. What will happen if we are not using the earth continuity cables? Because our receiving end is open, so when the transient voltage will be there, there will be a vicinity between the highest potential and the minimum potentials. So in the absence of the earth grounding, the current will flow through the ground and it can be damaged by the nearby equipment. So just we have to use the ECC for following the return, for providing a return path conductor for following the fault current. What are requirements of the ECC? It should be able to carry the single phase short circuit current, starting temperature and the ambient, and must be placed in the induction free manner to avoid difference in the potential or the circulating current. Why we are mentioning here the starting temperature and the ambient? It is very important for calculating the single phase short circuit currents for the earth continuity cables. Because generally you see our XLP cables can withstand maximum up to 250 degrees centigrade under the short circuit conditions. And under normal condition, generally we are considering in the 90 degree under the normal conditions in the case of the power cables. But in case of earth continuity cables, under the normal conditions, the temperatures of the earth continuity cable will be equivalent to the ambient temperature. That's why just we are saying we have to select the starting temperature as a ambient temperature, not 90 degree centigrade as specified in the IEC standard for the power cables. Because earth continuity cable is also a conductor. So when we are passing a current through a power cable, so the induced voltages can also develop in the earth continuity cables because these are will be laid nearby the cables. So this should be transposed between the middle of the circuit. So it will neutralize the induced voltages which will be developed in these cables. As per the SIGRET 283, the new standards, we can also use the two earth continuity cables in the case of large cables where the induced voltage will be much more higher as compared to just we are considering only the 65 volts. But in India, generally, it is not practicable. Last, just we are discussing about the cross bonding scheme where we are mainly adopting in the metro cities where the route length is beyond 1.5 or 2 kilometers. The cross bonding is also important because the power requirement in India is going increasing day by day. And we have already seen the induced voltage depends on the conductor current. If let us say if we talk about the 2500 square mm cable, that is the highest size in the cable industry, the current carrying capacity of these cables is around the 1300 or 1400 amps. The induced voltage will be much higher for the 500 meter length in this case as compared to we are using the 630 square mm cables. So where the route length is around the 1500 meter, so just we are providing the 500 meter drum for the cross bonding. The minimum length section should be 3. The minimum should be 3. You can see here, this is a typical example of a major section where we have divided into three equal sections. Section 1, section 2, and section 3. You can see here the initial point of the section was directly earthed and the last end of the section 3 is directly earthed. And between this, at the end of the section 1, this is the R phase, just we are transposing the sheath here to neutralize the induced voltages. You can see here the graph also, at the initial point of the section 1, the induced voltage will be 0 because we have directly earthed here. As the length of the earthing section increases, the induced voltage increases up to the last end of the section 1, where we are transposing the sheath, so the induced voltage again goes on decreasing. But since the length of the earthing section again increasing, so up to the last point of the section 2, it will increasing. And finally, at the end of the section 3, it will be 0 because it is a directly earthed here. So this is a cross bonding scheme. The advantage of the cross bonding scheme is to limit the induced voltages up to the requirements. Safety, potential danger is as induced voltage occurs within the link boxes, however link box is closed. Due to the compensation of the induced voltages, practically no circulating current occurs. But circulating current will not occur only when the length of the all three sections will be equal. If there will be unequal sections, some circulating current will be there because of the difference in the induced voltage between the different sections. At the same point, the screen is connecting from end to end, improving the station's grounding. Without circulating current, the additional losses are minimal, almost eddy current only. That's why the losses in the single end bonding and the cross end bonding will be almost same. So we are getting the current in the conductors. In the case of single end bonding and the cross end bonding will be approximate the same. Length limit. As the induced voltages must not exceed the certain values, the cut length of the individual cables is limited. Several cross-bonding systems can be connected in serial, which allows a very long total length. Cost. Because of the additional requirement of the insulating joints, coaxial cables, link boxes, sheath voltage limiters, the cost will be much higher as compared to the single end bonding or the both end bonding. This is a typical photograph for a cross bonding scheme. Here you can see we at the joint point just we isolated the sheath of the receiving and the sending cables here, and we are connecting the conductors of the cable directly, and these sheath will be connected in the link boxes through the coaxial cables. You can see here coaxial cable, these are the SPL belt, this is a cross bonding box, and this is a cross bonding box, this is the R by B. So this is the transposition of the sheath shall be done in the link box only through the coaxial cables. This is the photograph of the link box. This is basically, this is called a cross bonding link box, because the cross bonding of the sheath happens in the link box. That way it is called as a cross bonding link box. Basically, these are the two photographs. One is the wall mounted and second one is the floor mounted. This is the grounding of HV joints. You can see another photograph. Coaxial bonding cables reduce the, just I will explain in the next slide why the coaxial cable will be required. You can see here, just we are talking about ki we have to use the coaxial cables in the case for the cross bonding of the cables. Or we can generally, all the customer ask the questions whether we must use the coaxial bonding cables or the single core bonding cables. What is the difference when we are using the single core bonding cables or the coaxial bonding cables? You can see here, coaxial cable is nothing. Okay, before the explanation about the coaxial cable, just I talked about the length of the earthing section must be equal. What happens if the length of the earthing section will not be equal? You can see here, there will be some moderate additional losses will be there if the ratio of the cross bonding length will not be one. What happens if we are using a three sections for a cross bonding system, let us say 0, 1, A, B, or C. What will happen if the length of the section A is not equal to the length of section B? Because of the difference in the induced voltage in both the sections, some additional circulating currents will be there. And because of these additional circulating currents, some current will be less in the conductor. So there will be less ampacity we are getting. And just we can easily calculate as per the IC standards, because of the additional losses, so our ampacity in the cables will be less as compared to we are not using the equal sections in the case of the cross bonding system. Because generally we are getting the problem in the metro cities, because when we do the route survey or when we are visiting the site, because of the some problems or hindrances, we are not in a position to place the position of the joint base equally. So generally, we in that case, just we have to calculate the currents, ki what will be the additional losses we are getting. If these are the within the limits, then we can go ahead. Now, just we are talking about the short circuit considerations in this. Coaxial cables. Generally, coaxial cables will be used in case of cross bonding systems. Cross bonding systems, we have already seen, you can see here, just we have to insulate the sheath of the both the cables. Receiving and the sending cables, and one end of the coaxial cable is connected to one sheath and second end to the outer conductor of the coaxial cable, and only one coaxial cable will be entered in the link box, and only one opening will be in the joint. So what happens when we use the two bonding cables in the coaxial cables? There will be two openings in the joint. So just to limit only one opening or only one penetration through joint, we must use the coaxial cable. This is regarding the water moisture or something. But what are the electrical effects of the coaxial cables? Because we are using the both the conductors in the same cable, so lesser the distance between the same conductors, so reactance will be less in this case. Because of the lesser reactance of the coaxial cable as compared to the bonding cables, impedance will be less. When under the short circuit conditions, impedance will be multiplied by the short circuit current, so transient voltages will be less, and it is a very important phenomena in the case of when some fault occurs in the cables. So we must use the coaxial cables instead of the bonding cables when we are doing the cross bonding. If you want to use the bonding cables instead of the coaxial cable, then you have to calculate the transient voltage in the case of the bonding cable. Just you have to calculate what is the distance between the bonding cable and what should be the length of the bonding cables. Last length of the coaxial cables or bonding cable, generally we say, should not exceed the 10 meters. Generally, it is defined in all the standards ki the length of the coaxial cables or the bonding cable should not exceed 10 meters. IEC also recommends it should be 3 to 10 meters. But when we see the joint base, if we are laying the cables double circuit or triple circuit, and we have to place the link box at one end only, and the JB length is around the 15 meter. In that case, just we have to calculate the transient voltages. If the length will increase beyond the 10 meters, what will happen? Should we increase the size of the cable to reduce the impedance of the cables? So just we have to calculate, or we have to do the complete engineering. But we must ensure the length should be within the limits of 10 meters only. I have already explained the exam coaxial versus single core bonding cables. Coaxial bonding leads have the benefit of a very low inductance. Single core leads, on the other hand, higher inductance. In the transient voltages, the inductance of the bonding lead is the most relevant parameter that influences the over voltages at a screen sectionalizing. Now, one more thing, equipment is required in the case of the single end bonding as well as the cross bonding system. That is a SVL, sheath voltage limiter. Generally, we say ki by hypothetical rule, just we must use the 3 kV SVLs for 66 kV and 6 kV for the 220 kV and above, or 132 kV and above. But generally, we have to select ki how just we can select the sheath voltage limiters. Once the over voltages are known on each cable section in power frequency mode, normal operation as well as the short circuit current, then the appropriate SVL is selected as follows. First, we have to calculate the induced voltages under the normal and the short circuit conditions. The maximum continuous operating voltage of the SVL must always be higher than the maximum induced voltages at the cable section during the short circuit. This is highly important if not inevitably destroyed. Means if we are getting the induced voltage around the 4 kV, then we must use know the continuous operating voltage of SVL should be more than 4 kV. And second, the residual voltage of the SVL must be lower than the withstand voltage of the cable outer jacket. and joints outer protection. Why we are saying? Because if the residual voltage of the SVL is higher, what will happen? The SVL will sustain here and our distant voltage of the cable outer jacket is less, our outer jacket will be damaged. So the function of the SVL is to protect the cable outer jacket. So the residual voltage of the SVL must be lower. Because if the voltage will be higher, so SVL must go on, but the cable outer jacket should be intact in that case. These are the key how we have to select the bonding cable selections or SVL selections. This is the maximum system voltage of the main cables. You can see here the 72.5. Basically, this is a 466 kV cables, just we are talking about. Rated impulse voltage, this is the rated impulse voltage for the main cables, 66 kV cables. And we are talking about the impulse levels between the parts or each part to earth. Here we are talking about the impulse level of our bonding cables as well as the SVNs. These are the photographs. We are just, this is a SVL in the link box. And the left one, just we have to install the SVLs at the base plate of the terminations. Thank you.
Surendra ji, thank you very much. It was enlightening. Wow, wow session. No words. I'm speechless, mind blowing. And before I invite you for question and answer, because I have list of questions to ask, I would like to invite respected Bhai Sahab, he's here, to say a few words. Kindly unmute, sir, and say a few words. Then after that, I'm going to invite Anjali ma'am also for 1 minute.
Very honorable experts and distinguished participants for this very rich, very important conference on HV cables. See, I must appreciate a lot, take much of time because there must be many questions which Rajesh has to take care for replying. But I must say this is a wonderful initiative Mr. Rajesh Arora has taken to create the source of dissemination of knowledge for us, this IPL. What is important is that I'm using the word Mr. I'm not, like, I must use the word doctor, because 10 years, these last 10 years, he has worked very hard, really very hard. He has worked and, in a very dedicated and disciplined manner. He obtained the PhD degree, then he has taken many initiatives, started the campaign that there should not, the country should be free from the accidents. There should not be any accidents. Noble cause has already started by him. Then he has started this group very shortly, having the experience of this webinar, you see, because of his initiative. So I must say, and then many other initiatives on Google and all that, every day I find he creates a new thing and it touches me most of the time. I say this is the real dedication all of us, which all of us must generate. If we take the accident, I'm coming to the accidents as the company has started. There are 30 deaths in a day on the average. And if you take 365 days, this is so many deaths, more than 10,000 deaths that they are taking place approximately. So the campaign is so good, so noble. We all join and appreciate his efforts, appreciate his initiatives, help him. I think besides our knowledge accentuation, you see all these, we are always worried about that we should reduce the distribution losses. We should try to reduce the number of damages to the transformers. But still, even the most loss of human beings in the country, loss of animals. So we must try to take care of all this. This is the Surinder Jain has done a wonderful job for today's conference. I remember we have heard all last 10 years. that how should we create the how should we help the knowledge of engineers on the cables, because cables are the areas which are, as and when there is a fault problem, there is a problem to the operation and maintenance engineer. And then besides that, there are problems in laying the cable. So all these areas, they are real areas of worry. And I remember 10 years back, we had the world specialist, Mr. Pire Orgard. So continuously 4 years, we had the conferences, three at Delhi, one at Bombay. And I'm happy Rajesh has picked up the very important subject, you see, for this webinar. And I must salute him for all the initiatives. And I think in the days to come, we'll all be benefited with this initiative and with the knowledge we are planning to accentuate that our objective will be achieved. I think all my best wishes.
Thank you for your blessings, words and words of appreciation. Now I would like to invite respected Anjali ma'am. Please say a few words.
Good evening, everyone. I didn't know, Rajesh, that you were an expert on cables. I thought you knew more about distribution transformers and thing. It is good to hear all this from you and Vahiji. I think he is your patron, so hats off to Vahiji also. And the webinar was very interesting. And I hope, you know, we will be having much more on this. The information sharing, you know, it is that is very important, because that is how people learn. So this initiative is really very encouraging. And thank you for it.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. Now, before I go for the question answer, Sanjay Agarwal is my mentor, my friend. Sanjay ji, please speak the line at least to encourage us, all this group member.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, please.
Rajiv, you are really a gem. You are doing wonderful thing, and creating a platform like this is of immense use to everybody. In fact, this has helped everybody come on a common platform and discuss all their technical points. We can put it, and in this journey which we are going to have now onward, I wish you all the best for not only this endeavor, all the future endeavors, all the future initiatives you are going to take. All the best, and keep doing good things for the fraternity and India. All
thank
the best.
You, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm quite sure with the blessings and grace of all the eminent stalwarts present here, we will definitely achieve what we want in our life. Now I'm coming back to the question answer. Sundarji, are you ready?
Yes, sir. Please.
Okay. I have seen your presentation. What I could understand, when we talk about the power cables, there are three applicable standards. When we talk about our surrounding SEGRE paper 283, IEEE 575, that was missing, you didn't touch upon, and IS3043, okay? Now, based on all these things, I am coming on the frequently asked question about earthing of power cables. First question in that series is, which part of cable is to be grounded and why?
Sir, basically, just I already told that there are the two metallic parts in the cables.
Right.
Conductor is a high potential, because we are applying a conductor voltage to a conductor. So in that case, the second metallic part should be directly earthed. So that is the metallic screen. In case of lead sheath cables,
But suddenly, what happens in case you are lead sheet cables, one cable screen is also available, as you have shown in your slide. What to do with that cable screen? Should we ground that cable screen, or we should not?
Sir, in the case of the in case of lead sheet cable, there are just we have a two type of screens there. One is the copper wire screening, and the second one is the lead sheet. So generally we do the plumbing between and the lead sheath and the copperwire screening, and we are shorting both the sheaths at the ends and ground there, because in case of fault, both the screening part of the cable, lead sheath and copperwire screening, share the fault currents depending on the resistivity of the materials.
Okay, means on the pore data basis, based on the resistivity, the current fault current will go back to the source through lead as well as the cable screen. Copper, yes, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, sir. Copper.
Okay. And we usually come across what? IEEE 575, if you see Segret 283 numbers of journal, they are not using only grounding. They are using grounding and bonding in power cables. Why they are using both words together?
Sir, generally they are using the bonding. First, the bonding of the sheath, or just we are doing the linking the sheath to the link boxes, and finally we are grounding here because just for flowing fault current. That's why they are using the bonding and the grounding the same word in the same sections.
But I would like to add one thing, sir. Yes. When you talk about the bonding, if you look at the picture shown, depicted by yourself, the purpose of bonding here is to bond all the sheets of all the single core cable together. That is the bonding part. Okay. When that bonding part is grounded with the help of electrode in the joint bay, then that becomes bonding and grounding of the cable. This is the complete meaning of that.
Yes, generally what we do in the joint base, let us say in the case of cross bonding, what we'll do, just we have shown you the only one part, that up to the link box. What happened after the link box, generally we are making a copper mesh, just we are providing a copper earth electrodes in our joint base, and we are calculating the earth resistance of the joint base depending on the electrical resistivity of the soils. And depending on the electrical resistivity, just we are calculating the earth resistance should be within the limits of as per IS 3043 or IEEE 80.
Okay. That means for each joint bay, you calculate separately for the grounding design. That is not fixed for each and every joint bay coming in a section of your cable.
Yes. Generally, sir, what we do, generally we take the data, soil data, at every 100 meters of a route, and generally we take the average values of the soil resistivities, electrical resistivities, and we calculate the resistances.
Okay, next week in the series of frequently asked question, the people are confused. Sometimes what happens when the cable length is quite low, the people prefer single side earthing bonding. Sometimes the people go for the two side earthing bonding, sometimes go for the cross bonding. What is the rule of thumb to select? Suppose I have one station, within my substation I want to lay cable of EHV cable. Should I bond it on both end or one end open? It's very confusing. Can we elaborate? The people are very confused on that question. I will add my point also.
Okay. Sir, generally in the substations where the route length is around 100 meters or 50 meters.
Right.
Using the cables, generally they use the higher size or generally they cable. The losses in the cables is very much less. And because of the safety aspect also, generally they prefer the both end bonding. But when we are doing a bonding for a route length of 500 meter or 700 meter or 1000 meters, and just we have to pass a considerable current around 700 amps or 800 amps, generally we prefer the single end bonding. We can also both end bonding in that case, but then in that case, just you have to choose a higher size conductor considering the circulating currents also. Okay. But cross bonding, for the requirement of the cross bonding, minimum three lines should be there. Let us say if you have a route length of around 2 kilometers, just it is a typical example, and your conductor size is only the 300 aluminium. And in that case, just we can supply the cable only easily 1 kilometer. In that case, there will be only two sections. So minimum sections are required for doing the cross bonding the cable. And just we have to design the optimum either cost wise or the electrical wise, both. Just we have to meet the electrical parameters as well as the cost, just we have to justify for the circuit.
Yes, sir. Apart from that, one thing was missing in your conversation. When we talk about the current carrying capacity in both handling system, that will reduce because of circulating current and the heat generated in the cable. Apart from that is very important. Am I right?
I must also include the cable and capacity formula in our slides also. It affects how the losses affect the capacity of the cables. Just I should also cover.
No issue. Now coming to the very next frequently asked question, the people are confused where to use sheet voltage limiter, where not to use, if we have to use, what should be the size, how to select it. Kindly elaborate on that part.
Sir, I already explained. Generally, the SVLs will be used in the case of the single end bonding or the cross bonding systems. Generally, we have a thumb rule. If we have a 3 kV in 66 kV cable, 33 kV cable, we are use the 3 kV SVLs. Basically, there are the very typical formulas. Just I have already shown there are the two main criteria. The operating voltage of the SVLs must.
You can open your slides again to elaborate that the people can understand it fully before they leave that session. Because learning is very important, and to learning in depth is also very important.
Yes, sir.
It is visible. Go to that particular slide. That is
okay. Selection of the proper SVLs.
Yeah.
Once the over voltages are known on each cable section in power frequency mode, normal operation, the maximum continuous operating voltage of the SVLs must always be higher than the maximum induced voltage at the cable section during the short circuit.
It's okay, it should be on the higher side, but what should be the limit? Suppose that induced voltage on a particular section comes out to be 3 kV or 4 kV. Then should I go for 8 or 9 or we should choose 6? How do you choose the value?
We should be near, we should select a nearby SVL, 6 kV.
But for that nearby voltage, that rating of SVL should be available.
Yes.
That is very important.
Yes, sir. That is very, very important. Generally, in market, there is a SVLs available 3 kV, 6 kV, 9 kV. Or some companies, I think, are manufacturing around the 8 kV SVLs. But in India, we are getting the 3, 6, and 9.
Okay. Good. Should I move to the next question?
Yes, sir.
My next question is that we are very confused. There are two types of earthing conductor. Your earth continuity cables is there, ECC or GCC ground continuity cables is there, but that is applicable when there is no cross bonding is there, no sheath is there. That is applicable when you want to have extra cable required to make your fault current back to the source with efficient path. Am I right?
Yes.
But what happens? Usually we are using coaxial and single core bonding leads. And
yes,
how do you choose size?
Sir, how we choose? There are the two parameters basically. Right. One is the short circuit current capability of the cables related to the current. And second is related to the you can see here the slides, impulse levels. So this is related to the voltages and the selection of the conductor related to the short circuit conductor current. Now, how we have to calculate the current of the short circuit current capability of the cables? It is very important.
Jain sir, in the slide, what you are showing, depicting here is about the voltage. My question is related to current. How do you choose the short circuit level and current, continuous current rating that bonding lead?
Yes. So in case of the bonding leads, there is no requirement of the continuous current because under the normal conditions, the cable will be completely idle. And the temperature of the bonding leads will be equivalent to the temperature or the ambient temperature. What is the difference between the, however it is a power cable, but what is the difference between the application of a power cable and a bonding cable? When we are using a power cable as a bonding cable, in case of power cable, you are continuously flowing the current. Under the normal conditions, the temperature of these power cables will be around the 90 degree as per the IEC standards. But in case of bonding cables, the initial temperature will be equivalent to the ambient temperature. So when we are calculating the short circuit current in this case, we have to take the starting temperature as the ambient temperature and final temperature depending on the your material. If you are using XLP, it should be 250. If you are using a PVC, it should be 160. If you are using a EPR, it should be 250. In that case, you can calculate the short circuit current of the cables. Generally, in India, we are using a one higher size of the cable because just we are taking a safety margin. We are considering as a initial temperature equivalent to the power cable.
You are right. I would like to add the requirement as per IEEE 575 is 375 square mm. Okay, 4 hour HV system. And if you look at the short circuit capability of that cable, it can easily carry the 63 kilo ampere.
Yes.
If I'm not wrong.
Yes. Sir, I appreciate you. You are the first one who had noticed this thing, because in earlier and older standards of 575, these sizes will not be mentioned. But when they revised their standard in 2014, 575, they have recommended. However, your fault level requirement is much less, but you have to choose this minimum size for this particular voltage grade.
Agreed. Should I move to next question?
Yes, sir.
What happens when a single phase to ground fault happens in our systems? Basically, the impedance offered by your sheath, that is zero sequence impedance of your cable, and that depends the location and types. For example, when 100% current is going back to the source to soil, when it is going half portion through your mother soil, and second part is going to your sheath, when all current is going to your sheath, the impedance level changes drastically. How do you take that in the calculation?
Sir, generally in that case, just we have to calculate the impedance, whether if we are considering along the conductor or whether the conductor in the ground, then just we have to calculate in the parallel. So just we can calculate the in the three fashions, through ground, through conductor, or whether in the ground and the conductor in parallel. So just we have to calculate according to that only.
Okay. Tell me one thing, talk about the capability of any cable for short circuit current flow. Which trifoil versus flat method, which one is better and why?
Pardon, sir?
There are two methods of laying of cable, trifoil method and a flat formation.
Yes, sir.
In which case, the capability of cable to take care of the fault current will be better?
Sir, the fault capability of the cables will be same.
Because it depends on the thickness of the sheath, if I'm not wrong.
The capability of the cables, the fault capability of the cables depends on the three factors: initial temperature, final temperature, and the basic properties of the earth carrying component of the materials.
That is the sheath in that case. In your cable, sheath is taking care of
all the. However, in the case of trefoil or the flood formation, your continuous current carrying capacity may vary, but the short circuit capacity will be the same.
And when we talk about the continuous current rating, which is better?
Sir, flat formation is better because
of good heat dissipation factor.
Yes, sir. Because of the good. Yes, sir. Very true.
Okay. Now, what I could understand when we talk about the short circuit level of your cable and the fault current going back to the source, the everything revolves around sheath. How to ensure the healthiness of sheath? How to test it?
Outer sheath.
Yeah.
Sir,
you were talking about 10 kV testing like that.
Yes, sir. Just I have shown our basic diagram of our cables. You can see here, after the P jacket, just we are applying a extruded semicon or just a graphite coating.
Okay.
So just we are using as an electrode, this semicon layers over the jacket, and second electrode, just we are using a sheath. And between these electrodes, just we are applying a voltage, 10 kV DC after laying of the cables. So for whether there are damages in that during the laying of the cable, so for ensuring the sheath integrity of our cables, just we are doing the testing at 10 kV DC for 1 minute.
Okay, good one. Our
has a much better capabilities of the carrying the voltage.
That is to be performed at the site after laying of your cable?
Yes.
Okay, good.
That's why, sir, yes, we are applying a extruded semicon layer or the graphite coating.
Great. Now, yeah. FAQ is over. Now I am inviting 3 questions. There, I have seen the chat box. 3 participants were very excited. In fact, yeah, very excited right now. And I would like to invite, first of all, respected Amit Bhatia ji, he has so many questions to ask.
Yes, sir. Because EJ, sir, very big personality in the power system.
Yes, I know. I have used respected already.
Yes.
Thank you, Rajeshji.
Yes, sir.
It's a very good subject which has been picked up for this interaction. There are questions. Some of the questions which I wrote, in fact, have been answered during the making of the presentation. So I'll only pick up only those wherein I still find that we can have a discussion. For example, distance between the link box and the cable, he has discussed a maximum 10 meters. Selection of sheath voltage limiter has been discussed.
I tried to cover all your questions from my side.
Thank you so much. Now, I am in fact still wanting to have the details of how the size of the sheet bonding cable is selected. Most of the time it is selected as 240 square mm copper.
Sir, I have answered. Basically, dash should be 375 as per IEEE 575. For the higher side, 400 square mm should be chosen always. I can give you a calculation. You can contact me after that session.
Yeah, sure. Thank you. Okay. And there was one question, like, what is the maximum sheath standing voltage permissible?
60 volt as per IEEE 3043.
Yeah, in Europe and some of the other countries, even 150 volts is permitted. So here, I find in India, the systems are designed for less than 65 volts. So my question was, why this differential is there? Why, when systems with 150 volts are permissible, why in India only 65 volts? Is it something to do with the standard only, or
generally, are there other reasons? Sir, I agree with you. Generally, it depends on the safety factors only.
Yeah.
In some European countries, or just you can refer also the IEEE 575 in the last annexure, so many voltages, ki some countries are following the 60 volts, some are following the 90 volts. In India itself, now the sizes of the cables are increasing.
Yeah.
The most of the some utilities are using the 2500 square mm cables or 2000 square mm cables. Yeah. And the carrying capacities are much higher as compared to earlier we are using, because generally In past, we are using the cables, only 1000 square mm cables, where the current requirement is only the 500 amps. So yeah. For the 500 amps, and we are supplying the supplied length is around the 500 meters. So just we are getting the induced voltage only the 60 volts. But now the utilities are thinking for the higher voltage grades, like 400 kV voltage grades, where the induced voltage is much higher because of the induced current. And in case of the 400 kV cables, even they are laying the cables in the flat formations. So because of these factors, the cable laying in the flat formations, and in the some utilities are thinking, just I can give you the name after the presentation, they are considering the 150 volts in India.
Yeah.
Yes, I can give you the name of the utility also, sir.
Okay.
Mr. Any more questions? Should I go to next candidate?
Just one more question. This is a practical problem which a DMRC has been facing, that in case of a SVL failure in one of the link boxes in a cross-bonded system, it makes their life very difficult to identify which SVL has failed. Because if the circuit length is 8-9 kilometers en route, there will be many link boxes. How to find out which SVL has failed, which SVL has caused the fault?
Sir, so, at present, there is no mechanism for checking the failure of SVLs. Only there is a preventive maintenance when we are doing quarterly or half yearly or yearly basis. Only in that case, just we can check.
Okay. So practically, they have to open up all the link boxes to see. Yes. Which SVL is which section
exactly has failed. Exactly. Coming to the next one, S. Raja has many questions to ask. I invite S. Raja, please unmute yourself. Then after that, there is one short name, TC is there. Please be ready. I am going to call you because at sharp 6:31, I am going to close. Mr. S. Raja.
Yes, sir. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Sir, actually, I have a small question. Some of the two questions I posted in the comment
box. Please.
Sir, we have in generating power station. So, in that, we have a small length of cables having a 33 kV rating. So, in that, we have only 50 to 100 meter of length. So, in that condition, is it necessary to do that refoiling arrangement? Because for that small length also, it will take much more area in the switchgear boxes. So is this necessary to do that trifold arrangement?
Trifold arrangement reduce the size basically. Flat formation will need more space.
Yes, sir. Is there any effect on proximity because of this not doing that trifold arrangement?
If you don't have any space constraint, it has already been explained by Jain sir. Try flat
element
is better.
Yes. And moreover, sir, generally in the generating or power substations, generally the cable will be laid only on the trays in trenches. So generally it will be no problem in the currents just you are getting. Because generally when we are laying the cables underground, then there will be we are getting the less.
Right.
You are laying your cables on the trays itself.
Yes, sir. In some of the Taishna, so we are getting the cable failure. We don't know exactly what is the reason, whether it is water accumulated in the underground or whether it is the effect of proximity. So in some
based on my experience, it may be the ingress of motion in the cable. And you have to take care of that thing, whether some motor is penetrating into the cable in some places or not. That may be the cause of failure within the substation, I think. Am I right, Jain sir?
Yes, sir, you can do one thing. If there is a problem in the of the water in the substations, then you can do one thing. You can procure the watertight cables in that case.
Right, very good idea.
In that case, water will be conductor will be watertight, and just you are getting the longitude of water moisture barriers itself. So there will be no problem. Second, overheating problem is only happens in that case if you have not selected the proper design of the cables. If you have you have to choose the right connector size, in that case, there will be no overheating. Second, there will be must be any loose connections at the termination ends if there will be some overheating of the cables. These are
Rajesh sir, apart from the important role for procurement of any cable is their specification selection of cable as per the requirement. If you are choosing as per your specification requirement, the most of time the 50% problems are over.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. The last question, the nickname I have seen is TC. Please unmute. I am not getting your full name for that.
Good evening, Rajesh sir. Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Sir, my name is Sering Chospel. Sir, my question was regarding the SVL, when to use SVL.
I already explained.
Yes.
Any more question?
Yeah, sir, there was a difference I have observed between aluminum sheet and aluminum corrugated sheet.
Yeah, actually the difference is the current carrying capacity and source circuit carrying capacity only. And what the thickness has direct impact on your losses also. And that is a part of losses calculation. And you can't change anything, that depends on the specification you have prepared. Actually, the OEM will provide you a cable of that size type.
So when to prefer corrugated sheet, sir?
Corrugated sheet, basically, as I already explained, when your cable doesn't have lead and copper screen, go for the corrugated sheet. Otherwise, both the screen and the lead sheet will help in that case.
Sir, may I? I have seen your query in the chat box. Just to want to know the difference between the aluminium screen and the aluminium sheet, corrugated aluminium sheet.
Okay. Yes, sir. Sheet, yeah.
Just when we talk about the aluminium screen, it can be aluminium wire screening. When we talk about the aluminium sheet, generally there are the two types of aluminium sheet. One is the smooth aluminium sheet. Generally in India, nobody is following this practice. Second, the corrugated aluminium sheet. In the case of the corrugated aluminium sheet, generally the corrugation will be applied for the flexible. When we are bending the cable, the flexibility will be applied for the corrugation. And because of the corrugation, you are getting the better mechanical strength. And because of the, you are getting the more aluminium component, which will be able to carry your required fault levels. As already told, where there is no requirement of the lead, generally the corrugated aluminium will be preferred. But you have to know, in the case of corrugated aluminum sheet, you are getting less current as compared to the lead sheet. Because of the aluminum sheet, you are getting the more aluminum. So the resistance of the aluminum sheet cables will be aluminum sheet. So eddy current will be more as compared to the lead sheet cable. So these are the basics.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Come to a point where I have to end my session, and I want to thank everyone once again.
Thanks a lot.
And I would like to thank once again Vai Saab, Sundar Jain Ji, Jash Ji, everyone present here. And we are here all because of your support and words of appreciation. Please stay with us. Keep sending your requests for more webinars. We are here to help you out. It is our forum. It is my forum. It is our group. And we have to make to high level together to that group. Thank you once again. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir. Thank you all. Our group about the session.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.